Hello, everybody. My name is Yuri van Staden, and it is my honor to show you some simulation results of the quantum electron microscope for the next 10 to 15 minutes. But before I show you simulation results, let me reiterate why we need the quantum electron microscope, where it will be used, and how it works. Now, some samples are very sensitive to electron damage. And our current methodology of just bombarding the sample with electrons is way too violent for these samples to even exist after we imaged it, right? Or at least it's damaged beyond recognition. So with the quantum electron microscope, we think we have a scheme that reduces the damage probability for each electron that we shoot at the quantum electron microscope, allowing us to shoot more electrons per area without increasing the damage. Now, the way that this would work, if you would look at the slide and you see these two opposing mirrors, we call them grating mirrors. In between these mirrors, an electron can bounce back and forth and back and forth. Now, it can do so via the reference beam, this red trajectory. It can do so via the sample beam, or it can do so in a superposition of both beams. Now, let's assume that the electron starts off in the reference beam. Okay? I'll show it in this image. You see on the very top there, the electron starts in the red beam. Now, after the first interaction with the mirrors provoke some interesting physics as it redistributes the probability wave such that a slight chunk gamma is in effect stolen from the reference beam and transferred to the sample beam. So you see this small blue line starting to appear. Now upon the next interaction, another chunk gamma is transferred to the sample beam, and this reiterates itself until eventually all of the electron has been transferred from one beam to the other. Now what we have learned is that in this case, the electron would start in the reference beam, end up in the sample beam. Now, if we were to introduce a sample into the setup, then this would change things, because after the first interaction between the mirror and the reference beam, again, a slight chunk gamma is put into the sample beam. However, upon commute of the probability wave, it now encounters a sample, effectively measuring it. It is forced to assume just one of the two trajectories instead of a superposition. And if you chose gamma small enough, the probabilities are in favor of the electrons collapsing in the reference beam. So again, the grating mirror invokes a chunk gamma to be transferred to the opposing beam. It encounters the sample, forcing it to collapse. If gamma is very small, the chances are that it will collapse in the reference beam, re-implying the initial conditions. Now, if we iterate this a couple of times, nothing will change, and we are left with, at the end, a certain chance of the electron ending in the sample beam, just as before, when there was no sample. However, now there is also a chance of the electron ending in the reference beam. And this could not have happened if there was not a sample. So if an electron collapses in the reference beam after the experiment, we know that there must have been a sample changing the physics internally. Now, there is, of course, also a chance that the electron does, when it is provoked to collapse by the sample, that it does collapse in the sample itself instead of in the reference beam. Now, if this happens, the electron is lost, and we want to minimize the chances this happens, and we can do so again by lowering gamma. And that's what I'll show you in these on the next slide in these simulations, where on the top left you see a dummy sample, and the two images under that are simulations of a scanning transmission electron microscope, the bright field and the dark field. Now, if we were to image what the detectors would see when trying to image this dummy sample on the top left, then we would get three images corresponding to three detectors, the reference beam, the sample beam, and possibly a scattering detector, the damage beam. Now, as I said earlier, if we lower this chunk gamma, the probability of an electron collapsing in the sample gets smaller, allowing us to shoot more electrons per area without increasing the total damage, and thus increasing the image quality. And I will lower gamma now. You see, I keep on lowering it in this quantum electron microscope, and the image gets better and far supersedes the scanning transmission electron microscope case. Now, to tell you a little bit about how the simulation works itself, if we were to have a dummy sample as before, or in this case a protein, we divide it into a grid of pixels, and at each pixel with a Poissonian electron gun, we shoot a certain amount of electrons. Now, where these electrons end as opposed to where they are aimed at depends on a Gaussian probability function. And the characteristics of the sample are extracted from those places where the electron actually ends up. And these characteristics are placed in our quantum electron microscope model, as we discussed before, with a certain gamma. However, what we didn't discuss were these two other symbols we see here, the alpha and the phi. Because where I previously said that if we were unlucky and the electron collapsed in the sample, then it would damage it, that's not true. Because there's also a chance that the electron goes straight through the sample, even though it's in its path. And this is characterized by the transparency alpha. And let's look at what alpha does to the probabilities of ending in the reference beam, the sample beam, or the damage beam. Here we go. What we see here on the y-axis is the probability, and on the x-axis we see the transparency. Now, transparency of zero is the situation we discussed earlier, where there's a sample which will not let an electron pass through whenever. And on the right, when alpha is one, we have the situation drawn on the right where there's no sample at all. The green line is the damage that would be invoked by the scanning transmission electron microscope. And the black line is what would be invoked by the quantum electron microscope for a fairly large gamma, or the largest we can choose. Okay, so there's already a big advantage that seems to arise from the quantum electron microscope, but as this loss probability, this black one of the quantum electron microscope, is always lower than the green one of the scanning transmission electron microscope. Now, let's try to further improve this damage reduction by decreasing gamma, as we said earlier, right? The damage per electron should decrease. Unfortunately, when we do that, we see here on the slides that I'm gonna decrease the gamma a few times now. You see that the damage probability actually rises, okay? And if we continue to decrease gamma, I'm gonna do that, we see that it does get quite high. However, it is all pushed to one side. Now, we can utilize this by trying to choose an energy of the electron and characteristics of the sample such that the transparency falls within the range that avoids this big loss bump. If we do that, we see a massive decrease in loss probability, and that's what we want eventually. However, there is a price to pay, because if we force ourselves to be in this low alpha range where the loss is small, we will also notice, I'm going to depict on the slides now, this red line, the reference beam probability, is the opposite of the damage probability here and very flat. So in the low alpha range, we have low loss probability. However, the reference probability is very flat, which tells us that for differing alphas as an input, for different sample characteristics, we hardly get a difference in output. Okay, so that means that there is low ability, it's hard to produce gray values with the quantum electron microscope in this case. However, the loss probability is very low, which is the advantage, which allows us to shoot a lot of electrons per area, giving us the opportunity to produce images that have little gray value but very high resolution contours. Now, we can see that in the next slide where I show you some simulations of a, on the top left you have the dummy sample. This is a simulation of a sample that is completely opaque in the middle and increases in transparency towards the sides. Now, what we see for our big gamma, all these detector outputs show us that there are gray values, right? We see a slow transition from white to black. When we reduce gamma, however, this gives us the disadvantage that the gray values diminish, so we only get to see the contours. However, these contours are of very high resolution, and we think that this can be very useful because it can be useful. You can learn a lot about a sample when just seeing the contours. You can learn something about how the structure is built up and so on, like this beautiful butterfly you see on this slide. You don't need a lot of gray value imaging to recognize that this is a butterfly and see how the wings are kept stiff and whatever. So we think that contour imaging could be an application for the quantum electron microscope. Now, there is something else that I have not mentioned so far, and maybe you noticed it in the beginning when I explained to you about the simulation itself, and that is that I also omitted to tell you about phi. Phi, which represents a phase shift. Because when an electron, and when we're unlucky and the electron collapses in the sample beam and approaches the sample, this alpha told us that the electron had a certain chance of passing right through the sample. However, and this phi will tell us that when this electron passes through the sample, its phase will be shifted compared to the part of the electron that is going through the reference beam. And this has implications when the beams are connected again at the next iteration at the grating mirror. So this can have a big influence, and we can see the effect of the phase shift in this next graph, or in this next slide. So again, what we wanted was on the y-axis the probability of the electron ending in a certain beam, and on the x-axis we have the phase shift that is induced on the electron in each interaction with the sample. Now, what we see, this was for a reasonably high gamma, where the loss probability was a little bump. Now, I'm going to click on this little thing about five times now, and each time the phase shift will be increased with an increment of 0.1 pi. So take a look at this slide and notice what happens when I include the phase shift. Okay? So we're going to do it 3, 2, 1. So what happened was that the probabilities were suppressed in favor of the reference beam and diminished the loss probability. Okay? Now, since we want as small as possible loss probability, we would want to stay on the right side of this graph where alpha is reasonably high. And another advantage arises when we stay on this high alpha range. This advantage is that the reference beam probability changes violently for small increments of the phase shift. So I'm going to go back these five clicks again, and what you will see is that this red line changes violently on the right side. Check it out. So we're going to make a graph restricting ourselves to this alpha is 0.95, okay, on the very right side, and actually plots how the reference beam changes and the damage beam changes with the phase shift. Now we see that here, we see the phase shift on the x-axis, And we indeed see that for a small amount of phase shift, the reference beam goes up violently. We also indeed see that the loss probability goes down as the phase shift increases. Now, idealistically, what we would want is to invoke characteristics of the sample such that the alpha is on the very right side of the previous graph, and that the phase shift is large enough that the loss probability has this little dip that you see in the middle, right? Because if we go to the left of this dip, and let's say we decrease gamma again, so we're going to decrease gamma, what we see is that the loss probability in the dip decreases even further, what we want. However, on the sides, the loss probability increases very violently, exactly at the place where the reference beam changes very violently. So we want to stay away from these places where the loss probability is very high, so we have to stay away from gray value imaging where the reference beam probability changes very steeply. We want to be in the middle. Now, what we want to do is investigate for different electron energies and different kinds of samples if we indeed can get characteristics of the sample such that the phase shift is somewhere, in this case, maybe at the 0.4 side, and we get a high alpha that would produce this graph. However, now I've only tested it for one electron energy, 20 kiloelectron volts, and it produced a phase shift that is very close to zero in this case, and thus did not give great images. However, it did give gray value imaging. However, the cost was damage. So gray value imaging was possible. I'm going to show you now the simulation results of an actual dummy of a protein. And we see that there is gray value imaging at the beginning. This is because the characteristics of the sample are not optimal for this microscope. So I got to play around with the energy of the electron a little bit. However, we do see the point that if we decrease gamma very much, and in this case it's absurdly much, but I got to find the appropriate sample, and we hope that the characteristics will be less absurd. But on the very right side, we see a very beautiful, very sharp contour of the protein, and this is what we hope to achieve with the quantum electron microscope. So thank you very much for your attention. And I hope you learned something today. Ciao.